Good morning and welcome to Science Radio. In the previous three episodes, we covered the workshop on hippocampus from synapses to behavior held at ICER Pune from the 1st to the 3rd of December 2013. The workshop also hosted a musical night featuring the genius of percussionist Ustad Tafiq Qureshi. We were fortunate to have had the opportunity to chat with him.
I consider myself very lucky that I am born in a family where there was Ustad Allah Rakha and Ustad Zakir Hussain.
In today's segment, we will hear from Ustad Tafiq Qureshi about the wonders of music, his love for food, and a lot more. We chatted with Ustad Tafiq Qureshi in the media center at ICER Pune after his concert. This is Science Radio on Vidyavani 107.4. Welcome, listeners. Today, I'm talking to a pundit of Indian classical music and a wizard with all kinds of percussion instruments, Ustad Tafiq Qureshi. Sir, it's an honor to be talking to you today.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
To start off with, growing up in a musical family, was there any pressure on you to enter the same line?
Actually, never. Like you said, being born into a family, I consider myself very lucky that I am born in a family where there was Ustad Allah Rakha and Ustad Zakir Hussain. Actually, automatically, I was drawn to the rhythms, you know. And for me, there was nothing but the tabla, the tabla, the tabla, the tabla, the tabla, the tabla, the tabla. That rhythm constantly, from the moment I was brought to the house when I was maybe 5 or 6 days old, I've been hearing that sound. And automatically, I got attracted to it. And I was never forced into it. In fact, my mother tried a lot to veer me away from it, because in those days, music in 60s and all was not a great deal, you know. And she said, well, my husband is a musician, tabla player. My son Zakir is also. So I wanted this boy to become something else. And she tried a lot, but you know, I kept going through it. And my report card was never in the green, it was already in the red. So like my father said to my mother, he said, look, I don't think he's going to be doing anything else but music. So at the age of 12 was when I actually started learning. So I was never forced into it. In fact, I kept going back to it. So there, yeah.
You were mentored by Pandit Bhikkhu Vinayakram, maestro with the Ghatam.
Yes, I also was lucky enough to take guidance from him.
And you play, among many, many instruments, the djembe, which is a
West African instrument. Yeah.
So clearly there are a lot of influences here. Can you please tell us a little about which are the major ones?
See, basically, I wanted to study South Indian rhythms, because whenever I would collaborate with some South Indian musicians, I would find myself at a loss to be able to play with them. In a way, South Indians are a little bit strict with music, and they like their music to be the way it is, the rhythm and everything. So I said, well, I have to study this South Indian philosophy of rhythm, which is amazing, actually, once I really started understanding it. So I had the opportunity of traveling with Bhikkhu Vinayakram. So every time I would travel with him, I was sitting next to him in a plane, in the bus. I would pester him at the airport. I would go and knock on his door and say, Pandiji, can I come? And he would be so good enough to say, come sit. And so that's why many times I would go to Madras and take lessons from him. On the phone sometimes, he would give me a korway and all that. So that was there. Then I was looking for an instrument where I could define the tabla knowledge that I got from my father. And I was looking for that one instrument. And I tried my hand at various, the dumbek, the darbuka, the congas. And then I got the djembe in my hand. And I realized that this instrument is something where I can define the tabla knowledge. You see, the tabla has three important frequencies: the lows, the mids, and the highs. And all three frequencies one can explore through the djembe. I'm not defining the sound of the tabla, I'm defining the knowledge of that instrument. So that's why I started playing it on the djembe. And because I feel that rhythm is all around us, I can do rhythm with this bottle, you know. So the bottle is the kick for me. And this is the snare. And the hi-hat can be my mouse, right? So rhythm is everywhere. So I started exploring rhythm through my voice. So there, so I became a, you can say, an Indian beatboxer.
Okay. I've also read that you have developed a unique rhythmic language to adapt the tabla syllables onto
the djembe. Yes, yes.
When was this?
This happened because when I was teaching my students, I would reach them one day after 4 days when I would meet them, and I would ask them to play something, and they would not be able to play it the way I've taught it to them. So I used to get very upset with them. I said, what is this, yaar? And then suddenly it struck me that there is no language. The reason why we could retain whatever we learned from my father was because there was a language. Dha, dhati, dhagati, nagina, titi, gina, dhati, dhagina, dhagati, nagina, dha. And then I realized I have to have a language in order for these students to retain. So I developed a language as per the sound on the djembe. Like the center one is dhe. Like dha, on the tabla, I have dhe. For ti, I have pak. For tun, I have na. For na, I have a na, because on the edge when you play on the djembe, it sounds like a na. So I developed a language, and then I started making combinations of these alphabets or the language. I started realizing that if I have to play dhati dhaga tena ghinna, on the djembe it would be dhepa dhena tun tun na na. So it became easier for me to teach the students. They could write it, and the next time they come, they had a language to go back and refer. They could look at it and practice. So the next time they came, they remembered it.
And if you had to choose one instrument as your absolute favorite, which one would it be?
Myself.
Okay, the because vocals.
The voice. I think that's one thing which is one of my favorite, because it's something which, as of now, at least in India, only I can do these breath things and all these things. I used to do a lot of body percussion, you know, cheeks and all that. But I see a lot of other people doing it now. So that's fine. I do a lot of this breath and what you could call it like, a, you know, in and out, Kapalbharti kind of thing, which I use it to create rhythm. So for me, my favorite instrument is my own voice, my own body.
Well, in which case you must be taking extraordinary care of it. Secret is yoga?
The only thing which I do is I don't take cold things, because I am very prone to catching a cold or a cough if I even have a 2 to 3 sips of cold water or a cold drink. That's the only care that I take. Otherwise, I eat anything. I'm okay. I don't do yoga. Sorry. I should be doing it, but I don't do it. Neither do I do Kapalbharti, nor do I do any breathing exercises. Whatever I do for my vocal percussions is very natural and it comes naturally.
Quite amazing then, I would say. You've performed with hundreds of artists across probably the globe.
I'm lucky.
Who would you say is your favorite that you have your jugalbandi with and such?
My favorite artist as an instrumentalist, if you say, then the sitar, young maestro Niladri Kumar. He's one artist with whom I always enjoy collaborating and playing. And there's a tuning which I have with him, and I think he also has it with me. Whenever we play, we never look at each other. We don't decide. We just come in, just jam, and it happens. So that's for instrumentalist is concerned. I enjoy playing with him.
Okay. This is Science Radio on Vidyavani 107.4. Over the last couple of decades, do you feel that the following and appreciation for Indian classical music has gone down?
Yes, but of course classical music will never die, because that's music which, let's say, in the 70s people used to say, by 90s there will be no classical music, but classical music is still there. In the 90s they used to say, by 2000 end classical music will not be there, which is now 2000, going to be 14, but classical music is still there. So classical music will never die. That's like a root so strong, it can never go. But yes, the liking for it has reduced. See, when I was a kid, I would listen to 4 hours of one artist performing. And concerts would go on till 5 o'clock, 7 o'clock in the morning. Now, with time restrictions, God knows for what reason, the government thinks that, you know, classical music should not go beyond 10, 30, 11. Although I think classical music, we have rags which actually start after 2 o'clock in the night. So it's a loss that we cannot hear those rags. We have artists who can play those rags, but they cannot play it at 9 o'clock or 9:30 because wo moody nahi banta. So I'm saying that liking has gone down because people nowadays, life is very fast. Even when we go to a restaurant, we would rather ask, is there a buffet? So where there is a buffet, there is, you know, pasta, oh, there is this maki dal, oh, chicken, oh, salads. So even in music, we want a little bit of classical with a little bit of, you know, why don't we put a little bit of folk in it, and we bring in a little South Indian element there, and then kind of merge it with jazz. So we have a fusion concert. So people are enjoying more of that than classical music. They don't have the patience to go and sit through a 3-hour concert. They would rather go there, sit for 45 minutes an hour, then go off and, you know, hook up with some friends in some restaurant, and then from there go to a pub or a club or something like that. The young are shying away from classical music. They don't want to attend classical music so much, because I understand, because classical music for them is slow and it'll, you know, like that. But they are more interested in fusion music. That is why fusion music picked up a lot since the 90s, because the young would identify with it, because there's a rag, there's a tal. Like, for example, This evening, what did I do? We played Vachaspati, which is a very traditional South Indian raga, in Adi Taal, which is 8-beat. But we made it interesting with drums and sarod and that electronic sarod, and then me coming and doing these voice things. And then Geetika came and she sang one traditional jhula, which is a thumriyang, but backed by the djembe, which is from Africa, and makes it interesting. So the crowd also enjoys it, no? So the liking for classical music has diminished. But mind you, it will never go.
Do you think then it is the responsibility of the artist to keep up with what the needs of the people are?
Definitely. And that's what we are doing. Like, for example, today we did present classical music, but it's an old wine in a new bottle.
Okay. Now, if I had some free time, I would probably go and listen to some music. What would you do in your free time?
Watch movies. I love watching movies. At my home, the surround sound, loud. And then I go to theaters. Like I always tell my wife, that's one kharcha that I will not be able to avoid. Because I love watching movies. And I love watching movies in theaters. Action, horror. I love horror movies. Oh, man. So that's one thing which I enjoy, apart from eating. And I love going to various different kind of cuisines. I would go to Jafar Bhai and enjoy. Jafar Bhai is in a very downtrodden area in Mumbai, but I enjoy the biryani over there. And then I would also go to one beautiful boutique restaurant near Phoenix Mall in Mumbai, which is known as Good Earth, where they have a fantastic restaurant for tastings, where I would enjoy the salads and wine and cheese and all that. And I would also go at 2:30 in the night near the station to enjoy some nice bhurji pav and all that. So I love good food, man. I'm a foodie.
Going back to the movies craze, who is your favorite actor?
You're talking about in India?
Okay, let's start with India.
Well, Aamir Khan is one of my favorite actors. Okay. I love what he does. I think he's a very brilliant actor. He comes out with such unique things, and he's not one of those guys who shy away to try out something new. There are so many movies of his. He's done such a variety of roles and carried it off on his shoulders. I mean, even a movie like Thare Zameen Pe, he's like, you don't see Aamir, but you see he's there. He hits you in that way. So I love Aamir. And if you talk about Western actors, then in the current, nobody. But in the old actors, Clint Eastwood.
Ah, classic. Okay, so one last question. For some of us who may not be able to play any instrument perfectly or may not be able to sing, but we have hobbies, we like to play a little. What advice would you have to us?
See, basically, if you're going to pursue something as a hobby and as an enjoyment, then taking up a percussion instrument is much more advisable. Because percussion instrument requires less of your time and your energy than a melodic instrument. Like, for example, even if you take a guitar, then you'll spend about a couple of months first just trying to figure out how to keep those fingers there. Whereas a percussion instrument like a djembe or a conga, you just take and you start hitting it. The moment you hit the sound, you hit the instrument, there is a sound. Unlike the tabla, where you have to, you know, 5 months go in just the na, then another 5 months in the ti and all that. So taking a percussion instrument like a djembe or a conga is much more simple. And much more simpler than that is singing. You don't need any instrument. You can just go and sing. Because you see, singing and rhythm comes naturally to us. If I start a beat, you will latch onto it faster than if I were to give you a melody. If I say, you'll play it. But if I say, you might not be able to catch it immediately. So the rhythm comes to you faster than the melody, because rhythm is already inside you. So that's why I take up a percussion instrument, man. Come to me for djembe.
Definitely sometime, if only I was so lucky. Thank you so much, sir. We will not take any more of your time. It was
Thank you
truly
so much.
An
it was
honor.
It was a pleasure for me to be here, and all the best with this.
Thank you so much. We come to the end of yet another episode of Science Radio. Catch us again next week for another episode. Do write to us. Our email ID is radioiserpune, radioiserpune@gmail.com. This is your host, Saurajit Basu, signing off.